James Brown there showing that he's a great singer as well as performer. But as you just saw, performing on stage is not like singing in your bathroom. On stage, the vocalist with just the naked voice to project has to contend with the amplified din from the rest of the band. Midgeor explains.
See there that the what I did when I started singing a song, I was actually singing quite quietly and in very clipped areas, so I had to go very closely to the mic to actually do that. But as the song progressed and it picked up in key, the actual pitch and the power of the voice raised, I actually moved further away from the mic there, because if I stayed the same distance from the mic, the power would just be far too much. The levels and your desk out front and things would just go haywire. So you've actually got to control when you know you're going to sing loud to back off from the mic. And you can do, there's also other things you can do when you are singing a powerful high note, is to, at the end of the note, as the note starts to fade away naturally in your voice, is to come back into the mic again, which is, you're acting like a volume control on your voice just by using a microphone.
Do you do that on Vienna, that moving back in?
Absolutely, yes. The whole thing, when you're singing something like Vienna, where it's quite a high note, when you're holding a high note for a long sustained time, it's actually quite difficult to do. So when you're doing it, if I was doing this means nothing to me, oh Vienna, and I come back into the mic as the note is fading out, which gives you the impression that the voice is actually much more powerful than it is. Just by using it. It's like having a volume control and just turning it up and turning it down when you're hitting the real peaks.
When you're working close to the mic, don't you have problems with breath, noise and popping and so on, syllables?
In live work, you don't really hear that too much, depending on what type of microphone you're going to use as well. You should try and use a pop shield if you're going to be incredibly close to it. But most people, when they're performing live, you actually see them with the lips pressed right against the microphone. And it's simply because the closer they are to the mic, the better they're going to hear themselves through the monitors. There's always a monitoring problem when you're performing live. But in a studio, it's going to be very different. In a studio, the engineer will make you stand a reasonable distance away from the microphone to stop all the pops and noises and clicks and things that you get naturally.
When you're working on stage with wedge monitors or side fills, did you when you're starting out, find it a disorientating experience to hear your voice not coming from you, but from somewhere else?
It is a bit odd, but I seem to remember that just the joy of having monitors instead of trying to hear what was coming out the PA, you know, alone, because in the early days we just didn't have monitors. The joy of actually having a monitor overcame any disorientation that you'd normally get. There is something a bit strange about singing into a piece of metal and hearing it coming out a wooden box on the floor or at the side of the stage, whereas when you're sitting in your bedroom and you're strumming your guitar and you're singing away, you're hearing your voice from inside the room, you're hearing it with your ears and you're hearing it inside your head. But when you've got loud music on stage, you just don't hear any of that at all. You know, you've got to depend on a good monitoring system.
Remember too that performing as a vocalist involves learning about expression and dynamics, and they both stem from control of your breathing and posture. Now, a very important thing to think about is how to protect your voice against the rigours of constant performance. Check out former Rainbow vocalist, now with US heavy metal act Alcatraz, Al Stearlongs himself, Graham Bonnet.
When I was a kid, instead of walking around singing pop songs like most kids did, in those days, I used to be listening to the radio for people like Mario Lanza, Gigli. And when I was about 7, I remember walking around singing with this big voice, this little kid, you know, and it amused my parents. And so I sort of kept that up. And when I got a little older, instead of singing guys' songs, what I used to do was sing like the Crystal stuff, the Ronettes, in their key. And so it sort of opened up my voice a lot to use a lot of power.
Bible black and mystic night, after the moon's dying, dancing in a wheel of fire.
In a rock and roll band, it's a rock and roll life, but I'm very clean on the road usually. I don't drink too much, and I always make sure I sleep enough and eat the right things, which is very hard on the road sometimes because I'm a vegetarian. But I know that when I go on stage, I should never have a beer before or anything like that, because it really makes you dehydrate and then your voice disappears. So normally I drink water on stage and use a throat spray. It's just plenty of rest.
Sweet virgin, this child standing alone is sweet.
Your lungs have to be in good shape for a start, because that's what starts the whole thing, the air, obviously. And, you know, your muscles have to be in good shape. If I've been off the road for a while, I really ache from singing during rehearsals. I start to feel real pain. It's like someone's punched me in the gut. But it comes back after a while. The best way to sing is to bring the throat right up like this, instead of going, go, it comes right out. It's like being a sword swallower, you know, that's the only way to do it. Because then the throat is open, and it's like a, well, it's a pipe, isn't it, after all? And so if that's open, then the note can come out much better than going like this, because most people go like that for a low note. Oh, I'm gonna sing low, okay, you know. But it doesn't work that way, because that screws your throat up, obviously. And for high notes, I find it keep my head straight kind of thing. I don't know why, this works. For me, with high notes, it's more of a straight-on thing. But basically, what I like to do is just mess around a lot. We do stupid noises, you know, any kind of noise you like. That's great. You know, one of those, right? Thank you. Sorry. But that kind of thing really warms you up. Even though it might sound stupid, any kind of thing. And another thing to do, which I don't do, but I should, is to walk around like, let your jaw drop and just relax in here before a session. And then you really loosen up, all this just relaxes. You look like an idiot, but it's just something you do, you know.
Thank you, Graham Bonnet. We'll be looking at vocals throughout the course of Rock School, looking at ideas and harmonies, arrangements, style and expression. But for now, we'll leave you with the most exciting vocalists around, from Eurythmics, Annie Lennox.